I didn't push you.
Thank you, Junior Choir. Thanks a lot. That was wonderful. And I feel like I'm getting to know you.
Could we be joined up here by... Kids, can you just come up? We're not going to make you sing. Just come on up here, please, so we can just have a chat. We're going to have a chat about meaningful things in life. Yeah, wherever. Just come. Yeah, wonderful to see you. By the way, good morning, everybody. And good morning, kiddos. Great to have you here. Let me give you a little bit of an idea of what we're going to be talking about and thinking about in here when you're in your Sunday school. And it's an interesting topic. It really doesn't have any answers per se, but it's something that I want you all to think about. We're going to be talking about giving money away. Have you ever thought about giving money away, helping somebody else who is in need and you get in a position to give someone? Okay. So it kind of looks like this. So in our society, we have a few people way up here with a lot of money. And then we have a lot of people down here with very, very little money. And the people up here with a lot of money see the people down here with just a little bit of money. And they say, well, I think we're going to help them. And so they send money down to the people who have very little. And the people who have very little say, thank you very much up there. Now I can buy a can of beans. Thank you. And the person up here goes, wow. That makes me feel good. I just helped somebody down here. That is really neat. And they said, maybe I'll do some more of this. And they give a little more money. And then, oh, thanks for the can of beans. Thanks for the can of tuna. Oh, thank you. And you know, for years and years, for centuries, that's the way the system worked. People up here with a lot of money, well, they decide to give some money down here. So they can say, thank you for the can of beans. And then the people up here feel really, really good. Now here is the big question. Can you imagine if we changed the system whereby the people up here were actually, well, had to give more money for the disbursement to the people down below. And so they weren't making money up here, but they're really making money more here. And the people who were really, really poor kind of came up here and was almost equal. So they didn't have to give money anymore to these people because they had enough money now. But the price was, it wasn't just these people up here who just gave what they wanted, but they were forced to give a lot of money. And so the society looked a little more equal. Do you think that's a good idea? You do? Great. Julie, you're teaching good things in the Sunday school classroom. That's great. That's wonderful. I wish you guys were old enough to vote. That would help a great deal. So anyway, so that's what we're going to be thinking about. People with a lot of money, giving money, feeling good about it, but does that really help? Okay? So let's think about that. And when you go home, you may want to talk about it with your family. Say, gee, does that make sense? What does that look like? Okay. So why don't we stay where we are? And I'm going to remove myself from here. And I think, we need to light. Tara, were you going to light it? Tara hasn't lit it either. Talk to Julie. Have you thought about ministry?
Say the words. Oh, okay.
symbol of light, symbol of knowledge, symbol of warmth, symbol of freedom. We light this chalice as a symbol of our faith. Here we gather to celebrate hope and the infinite possibilities of love.
Tara, that was perfect. Thank you. Let's open up our service by turning your hymn books, please, to number 303.
Good morning. So we're going to begin our time for meditation this morning by using something called a singing bowl. Have any of you guys ever seen or used a singing bowl before?
Yeah?
Have any of you guys ever meditated before? Do you do that at home sometimes or pray or, sit quietly? Yeah? So this is the way that I like to talk about using a singing bowl is you make it sing, which I'll do here in a second, and you listen until you can't hear it anymore. Because if you listen for a while, you hear the sound goes on and on. And then when you can't hear it anymore, you listen to what's going on inside of you. Or you can listen to what's going on around you. But that's how we're going to start out, okay? So I'm going to get the singing bowl to sing, and then we're just going to sit and listen in silence for a while. And then I'll have some words to share.
Thank you.
Here we are, our day just beginning. In the midst of this ever-turning, ever-churning life on our ever-turning world. Amidst diseases and disasters and discoveries. Amidst caucuses and campaigns and celebrations. Among ministries and mistakes and miracles. Here we are. In these moments, let us notice our thoughts and remember that we are not our thoughts. Let us notice our bodies and remember that we are not our bodies. And let us notice our feelings and remember that we are not our feelings. In these moments, on this day, and always, let us find that larger peace that passes understanding. And let us listen and look for the larger patterns of life so that we can respond with courage, with hope, with wisdom, with love, and with mercy. For if there is to be love, if there is to be mercy, if there is to be peace, it will begin now, here, with us. Amen.
Thank you, David. You've certainly raised the bar for the junior choir. They used to just get by on their cuteness, but now they're good. Now they're really good. I mean, they record this stuff. It's fabulous.
Ever-wiggling bar.
So our reading this morning, Darren Walker, who is president of the Ford Foundation, of course, one of the major philanthropic foundations in the country. And he wrote this piece, I'm guessing, maybe 4 or 5 weeks ago, and it really sent a fascinating message throughout the philanthropic community. It's a matter of looking at philanthropy in a very different way. And this is what he has to say. The origins of formal philanthropy date from at least 1889, when the American industrialist Andrew Carnegie composed his Gospel of Wealth. He drafted this intellectual charter at the peak of the Gilded Age, when inequality had reached extreme levels. Carnegie argued, as many still do, that inequality on this scale is an unavoidable condition of the free market system, and that it was even desirable if the promise of wealth incentivized hard work. Philanthropy, he believed, would ease the pressure of rising social anxiety that followed from inequality, ameliorating the afflictions of the market without altering the market system itself. During the 20th century, an entire field of institutional philanthropy emerged and flourished in the pattern of Carnegie's mold. Iconic American families, Gates, Knight, MacArthur, Mellon, Rockefeller, endowed and expanded foundations that built schools and libraries, developed new vaccines, revolutionized agriculture, and advanced human freedom. My own organization, the Ford Foundation, has given billions to support everything from public television in the United States to microlending in Bangladesh. And yet, for all the advances made in the last century, society's challenges may have outpaced philanthropy's resources. Today, the cumulative wealth of the most generous donors seems a pittance compared with the world's trillions of dollars worth of need. Generosity, blooming as it may be from legacies of both Carnegie's age and the newly enriched, is no longer enough. The world may need a reimagined charter of philosophy, a gospel of wealth for the 21st century that serves Americans, not just American philanthropists, but the vast army of new donors emerging around the world. Feeding the hungry is among our society's most fundamental obligations, but we should also question why our neighbors are without nutritious food to eat. Housing the homeless is an imperative, but we should also question why our housing markets are so distorted. As a nation, we need more investment in education, but not without questioning the educational disparities based on race, class, and geography. Our self-awareness, our humility, shouldn't be limited to examining the problems. It should include the structures of solution, like giving itself. As the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said not long before his assassination, philanthropy is commendable, but it must not cause the philanthropist to overlook the circumstances of economic injustice which make philanthropy necessary. Too often, we have declined to question our own circumstances, a system that produces vast differences in privilege, and then tasks the most privileged with improving the system. Whatever our intentions, the truth is that we can inadvertently widen inequality in the course of making money, even though we claim to support equality and justice when giving it away. And while our end-of-year giving might support worthy organizations, we must also ask if these financial donations contribute to larger social change. In other words, giving back is necessary, but not sufficient. We should seek to bring about lasting systemic change, even if that change might adversely affect us. We must bend each act of generosity towards justice. This modern giving charter should look different in different settings. At the Ford Foundation, our efforts will focus on inequality, not just wealth disparities, but injustices in politics, culture, and society that compound inequality and limit opportunity. We will ask questions like, are we hearing and heeding those who understand the problems best? What can we do to leverage our privilege to disrupt the drivers of inequality? Many already are answering King's call, working intensely toward a world that renders philanthropy unnecessary. Ultimately, we each must do our part to ensure that giving not only makes us feel better, but also makes our society more just.
Good morning again. Are you alive out there? Good morning. Okay, good. Whew. Sometimes that's like the beginning of a nightmare, right? Oh. Maybe my nightmare, not yours. I don't know. To those of you I've not yet met, I'm Reverend Matthew Cockrum, a consulting minister with this congregation, and it is my great good pleasure to serve along with the Reverend Tom Goldsmith, the ministries and the missions of this place, which I believe and understand are also what you're here to do, not only to be nourished, but also to be prepared to nourish and to be out in the world doing that work. There are a great deal of opportunities in the life of this church for us to be nourished and to learn to better nourish. Some of them are listed in your bulletin. You'll see a number of new offerings in adult religious education, social justice, anti-racism, the Anti-Racism Committee, the environmental ministries. Some of the things that aren't on there include a new recycling campaign. You can recycle light bulbs, toothpaste tubes, the little crinkly wrappers from Clif Bars and the inside of cereal boxes at the Environmental Ministries table. It's a little bit of a fundraiser, but more than that, it's a way to get these kinds of things out of the landfill. So if you've been thinking all along, well, I'll just toss them, don't. Save them. Bring them here on Sundays. We'll collect them. Also, a reminder that our youth ministries are continuing to raise funds for their various trips. Our coming of age group is going to Boston this summer, and they're selling t-shirts and tickets to a dinner and jazz experience later on in the month, so stop out in the Elliott Hall for that. And one last thing that also didn't make it was a last minute request. I know that the parking lot up in Friendship Manor is really slippery right now, and one of us, Liza Smart, found herself stuck in the ice up there and has asked for any able-bodied folks who might be able to help her heft her car out to meet her by the coffee table after service today. So if you've got a few extra minutes and a little bit extra muscle, please stop at the coffee table and offer Liza your help. In these moments now, I invite you to take a few minutes doing what our youth sang about at the beginning of the service, getting to know each other and reminding each other that this is a place where we come to practice love. So as the ushers come forward to receive this morning's offering, please greet your neighbors.
The patron saint of Italy, Saint Francis of Assisi, was canonized in the year 1228 and became associated in later years with the patronage of animals and the natural environment. His name is often invoked on Earth Day celebrations, and the ritual known as Blessing of the Animals, which is performed in so many churches around the country around October 4th, it's done so in his honor. Saint Francis, whose generous heart endeared him to millions of people through the centuries, and whose name our current Pope chose because of the clear humility in which he lived his life, this same Saint Francis of Assisi first expressed a sentiment which has been popularized in our culture as kind of a norm of generosity. He said, "It is in giving that we receive." Now, these words have virtually become a cliche, but our culture accepts the notion of an inner, warm, fuzzy feeling that infects our spirit after we've made a contribution to a worthy cause. Actually, every minister I know tries to persuade his or her congregation during pledge drive that the greater the gift, the warmer the feeling you will experience. Endless studies in the social sciences verify obtaining this inherent reward for parting with one's riches for the sake of helping another. Some studies even go so far as to say that we can live longer lives when we are more generous in our everyday transactions. It is in giving that we receive some qualitative lift in our soul, an axiom which has motivated human generosity since at least 1228, and probably many centuries before that. How jarring our reading this morning must have felt for all of us who earnestly believe that philanthropy is simply pivotal to helping others in need and for leveling the playing field of economic inequality. There's a sense that the greater the philanthropic gift, the more society is helped. So how discordant the verdict rendered this morning by Darren Walker, president of the Ford Foundation, that financial giving is not enough. We're still operating, he says, from this 19th century model of Andrew Carnegie's gospel of wealth, in which the beneficiaries of the capitalist system ought to return a portion of their wealth to ease social anxiety that stems from inequality. Walker acknowledged that his own foundation, along with countless others, have indeed improved the lives of many around the world, and yet, society's challenges may have outpaced philanthropy's resources. Instead of throwing money at problems, which may make the thrower feel good inside, Walker proposes a new 21st century gospel of wealth that also addresses the underlying causes that perpetuate human suffering. Philanthropy can no longer grapple with what is happening in the world, but why? Why is there so much human suffering? Walker quotes Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., "Philanthropy is commendable, but it must not cause the philanthropist to overlook the circumstances of economic injustice which make philanthropy necessary." Walker, trying to keep the wealthy in society focused on social change, presents a real challenge to generosity, in which, as the affluent fill out their end-of-the-year charitable gifts, they must ask, if these donations contribute to a larger, broader social change. So the hard question posed today is really the same question that confronted humankind in biblical times. How do we help the poor? Is it by charity or justice? By voluntary contributions or by legislation? Human goodness, often expressed in voluntary contributions, yields a fine reward for the people who give. In fact, we have come, in many instances, we've come to measure human goodness by the magnanimousness of the gift. Mark Zuckerberg and Priscilla Chan are perhaps now considered the epitome of human goodness after surrendering 99% of their Facebook stock value for charity worth about $45 billion. But their largesse produces no legislative change that will honor the inherent dignity of all people. And by that I mean granting everyone their basic human right to food, clean water, housing, healthcare, education. Candidates in both parties vying for the presidency of the United States boast of America's existing wealth and power. But in the face of increasing poverty and homelessness, especially among children, we are painfully reminded how we, the richest country in the world, still deny these fundamental human rights to the poorest of our citizens. State legislatures are more passionate about tax cutting than social services. Tax havens are established that allow large corporations and wealthy individuals to avoid paying their fair share. And just to be clear, in case you're wondering, I am not Bernie Sanders' speechwriter. I'm really not. Although, if he asked, because he needed the views of a younger man, I might consent, but I would tell Bernie the place to start is with the great minister of the 20th century, William Sloan Coffin, who really summed it up perfectly. when he said, when the rich take from the poor, it's called an economic plan. When the poor take from the rich, it's called class warfare. The conservative columnist, I should say conservative-leaning columnist, David Brooks, rendered a surprising critique, it was probably about a week, 10 days ago, a critique of the two Republican frontrunners, Ted Cruz and Donald Trump. And in his article, he mentions that they are void of compassion, gentleness, and mercy. Wow. Mercy, that struck me as an odd choice of words. Wow. Brooks juxtaposed mercy with what he called Cruz and Trump's brutalism. He says their speeches are marked by a long list of enemies and vows to crush, shred, destroy, and bomb them. Even Bill O'Reilly, bless his heart, from Fox TV, almost incredulously asked Donald Trump if he really meant what he said, that he would, quote unquote, take out the family members of terrorists. O'Reilly couldn't believe Trump would put hits on women and children if he were elected. Trump replied, I do pretty severe stuff. And then the crowd around him erupted in applause. The racism of some Trump supporters has been well documented. At one rally last month in Las Vegas, attendees punched an African-American protester while the crowd yelled, shoot him, kick his ass, light him on fire, and Zeke Heil. Mercy. Mercy. Pope Francis just published a book called The Name of God is Mercy. The book gives an explanation of why he has proclaimed 2016 as a holy year of mercy. He writes that mercy is essential, especially necessary in these times when humanity is wounded. We suffer, he writes. We suffer from the many slaveries of the third millennium, not just war and poverty and social exclusion, but also fatalism, hard-heartedness, and self-righteousness. You wonder if he had anyone in particular in mind when he wrote that. And I think I got a pretty good glimpse of what the Pope means by mercy. The Pope mentions and indeed chastises those who he calls scholars of the law. They live attached, he said. They live attached to the letter of the law, but neglect love. These are people who know how to close doors. These are people who know how to draw boundaries. And the Pope stressed a moral sincerity over dogma. And he sounded like he graduated from a Unitarian seminary, when he emphasized an understanding, we need to understand the complexities of the world. And he also chose individual experience over rigid doctrines. Calling on the etymology of mercy, we're reminded it stems from opening one's heart to everyone. Opening one's heart to everyone regardless of what marks may be held against them. And Pope Francis likens it to a divine attitude, similar to the parable of the prodigal son. In that parable, sure you recall it, the human response of the father, the human response would be more punitive of the lad who squandered the family's riches. And the son would be lucky if he were allowed to live in squalor with the servants for the rest of his life. But instead,
He is shown mercy by the Father, who welcomes the Son with a huge feast. Now, if the Father followed the letter of the law and identified all the sins of his wayward son, love would have been completely neglected. There never would have been any love. There lies an inherent forgiveness in love. We cannot love without forgiveness. Merciful rather than exacting, the cold indifference of doctrine. In a more contemporary situation, Pope Francis recounted the time he was rector of the Collegio Massimo of Jesuits and also a parish priest. He writes, "I remember a mother with young children whose husband had left her. She did not have a steady job and only managed to find temporary jobs for a couple of months out of the year. And when there was no work, she had to prostitute herself to provide her children with food. She was humble. She came to the parish church, and we tried to help her with Caritas, our charity. I remember one day, it was during the Christmas holidays, she came with her children to the college and asked for me. They called me, and I went to greet her. She had come to thank me. She had come to thank me. I thought it was for the package of food from Caritas that we had sent her. Did you receive it? I asked. Yes. Thank you for that, too. I came here today to thank you because you never stopped calling me Signora. There is charity, and there's honoring human dignity. They're by no means exclusive of each other. Mercy means making no judgments. It reflects a divine attitude towards others and thus transcends rules, doctrines, and dogmas. So there are no judgments of immigrants and refugees. No judgments of the poor, no judgments of people with different skin color or sexual orientations. The heart opens and accepts the dignity of all people and honors the basic human right to exist without hunger, without thirst, or medical need, and homelessness. You know, the Pope speaks so much about mercy and only mentions compassion quite fleetingly. They're both necessary for impacting the world, but I think he sees mercy as divine and compassion as more human. I think he would say compassion, feeling the pain of another, would lead us to give in charitable ways to alleviate that pain quickly, with boxes of food, perhaps. Or in our case here, right here in our church, when we donate so generously to San Esteban at Thanksgiving and at Christmas. But in our compassion, in all those generous gifts, we still don't change the systemic causes of injustice, the system, the culture, the legislature, the laws, tax laws in particular, that make charitable giving necessary in the first place. Now, one of the most popular verses in the Bible when it comes to promoting social justice is found in Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and walk humbly with thy God. There it goes, love mercy. What does that really mean? Well, in the verses leading up to this grand proclamation, God presents his case to the people of Israel that they have been disobedient. There was no
justice in the land despite prophets calling out for it. He was telling the people they were insensitive to the needs of the poor and the marginalized. In fact, God held no punches in pointing out that their transgressions that made them feel, well, a little bit nervous, so much so that they wondered how they might be able to get back on God's good side. Of course, it never occurred to them to change personal habits or make amends to society to be more inclusive of those who are powerless. Instead, maybe it's human nature, what they decided to do was to bargain with God by asking if he would atone them with burnt offerings, like, just for starters, how about a one-year-old calf? Right, we'll give you this one-year-old calf. God said, no, I don't think so. And so what they did then was up the ante. How about our sacrificing thousands of rams with 10,000 of rivers of oil? Something comparable to offering $45 billion of Facebook value today. But once again, God said, no, I don't think so. And then they offered the inconceivable, sacrificing their firstborn sons. And God said, hey, hold it right there. This sacrifice stuff is crazy. It's just that serves no purpose. We don't need religious sacrifices, even though the law of Moses says that's kind of required. He says, we're not going to follow the letter of the law here. Instead, God says, you need a change of heart. You need to change the laws because they are nothing more than hypocrisy. Give them some advice. Act justly. Live with a sense of right and wrong. Provide equity for all. Walk humbly. Remove your pride gathered from the accumulation of things and become concerned about your neighbor, not just yourself. And then the tough one. Love mercy. Love mercy stems from an old Jewish concept which means loyal love or loving kindness. To show love to your fellow man, show mercy to your fellow man. In today's parlance, the enormous suffering caused by income inequality and harsh judgments about the poor can only be addressed if we love mercy to the point where we can make some societal changes. I mean, charity may take away the immediate pain of hunger. Mercy will allow us to live as respectful equals. A new gospel of wealth, called for by Darren Walker, changes the paradigm founded by Gates, MacArthur, Mellon, Rockefeller, Zuckerberg, etc. Good foundations, all of them. They all do good around the world. But the new focus has to be less concerned with alleviating the effects of injustice and more with eliminating the causes. Reading Pope Francis has kind of put me in a more religious state of mind. It helps lift me above the political morass of our inconceivably brutal and heartless candidates trying to earn the presidential nomination through pure vitriol. They have turned away from the suffering of humanity, yet claim to be religious in frightening ways. You know, if we think about it for a moment, it is impossible, it's absolutely impossible to embrace religion, to speak of transcendence without a change in social attitude. And so I'm going to conclude, since I'm feeling a little more religious than usual, I'm going to conclude with another saint, Saint Thomas of the Cross, a Spaniard who was canonized in 1726 and best known for his
exquisite poetry. He was a very, very talented poet. He said, "In the evening of life, we will be judged on love alone. In the evening of life, we will be judged on love alone." And he didn't mean this as a threat. You better watch out, you're going to be judged. As really giving credibility to the need to love mercy. It was not a matter of God sitting on a throne, judging us when our lives are about to expire. I think that line was more about a personal accountability, a reckoning with oneself. What have I contributed to making life more just? Overall, how have we touched those who are in great need? Were we merciful in grappling with the causes of injustice? The funny thing is, I can tell you, we think about these things more and more as we age. You know, what comes to mind as we age is not, gee, how closely did I follow the letter of the law? That's not what it's about. In the evening of life, we will be judged on love alone. So be it. May we conclude our service turning our hymn books, please, to number 168.
To know and feel and experience the sacred bonds that connect us all to one another is to love mercy and do justice. To recognize this implacable moral imperative of faith represents the kind of good religion that mixes well with politics. Amen.